Now at this time, you're invited to get out your Bible or your Bible app and go to today's reading from the New Testament in Matthew chapter 5. If you're going to use one of the Bibles on the backs of the chairs, you'll find the reading on page 934. And just so you know, you can take these Bibles if you need them or want them. So keep that in mind. So we'll be reading from the New Revised Standard Version. So depending on which Bible you have, the wording might be different, but the meaning is the same. A reading from the Beatitudes in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5, verses 1, 2, and 7. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up to the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Yes? Grace and peace to you, beloved. I am Amy Wilson Feltz, and I'm the pastor here at Morningstar. And as we begin today, I just want to remind you that we highly value children in this community, and we have a higher number of kids in the service today, and some of them are new to our community. So just a gentle reminder, the sounds of children are not noise. The sounds of children are signs of life in community. Amen. So we're so glad to have the sounds of children. We also have a youth word of the day. I have a word here from Job and Jude. So if I can work this word into the sermon, then I get to keep my dollar. If I can't, or if I forget, then they get a dollar. So we'll see. We'll see how I do. Please keep your Bibles open to Matthew chapter 5 and also be ready to turn to Matthew chapter 6. Matthew 5 and Matthew 6, but also I'd like you to bookmark Luke chapter 23. So Matthew 5 and 6 and Luke chapter 23. Let's take a deep breath. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts together be pleasing in your sight this morning, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. In the home of the Feltz Five, that's what we call ourselves, the Feltz Five, we make it a practice to offer apologies and to accept them when we have hurt each other. And the goal, of course, is that these apologies would be sincere. Several months ago, I noticed that Augie, our 8-year-old, had begun responding to apologies with the phrase, "I forgive you." Not, "It's okay," or "not a problem," or "don't worry about it." "I forgive you." I also noticed that the phrase, "I forgive you," also served to irritate some members of the family. Like, what does he mean, "he forgives me"? Like he was casting blame on the rest of us and not really participating in true resolution. It's tricky, isn't it? We are now 5 weeks into our series called Happy, the Meaning of Life, and we're focusing on the Beatitudes of Jesus, the blessings that we find in Matthew 5, verses 1 through 11. Remember, blessed means happy, and the premise of this series is that Jesus, in his teachings, actually gives us the meaning of life, and it was never meant to be a secret. So to recap the past 4 weeks, the blessings of Jesus in Matthew 5 teach us to find the meaning of life in disadvantage, in grief, in gentleness, in advocacy for the needs of others. These are not easy teachings. In fact, some of the most consistent feedback that I have received about these sermons... Can I have my water, please? Some of the most consistent feedback that I have received... Thank you. Is that these sermons are hard to hear, especially the one about gentleness. These sermons are hard to hear because these are difficult practices. This is to be expected because the kingdom of God or the kingdom of God is upside down. If we're living according to the teachings of Jesus, the first will be last. To find, we must be willing to lose The poor are actually rich. The proud will be humbled. The greatest among us are those who serve. And life comes from death. And this kingdom is not merely some hoped for reality, but it is a present reality that we can experience here and now by the grace of God and by our grace too. And so much of that grace can be experienced through forgiveness. So let me just say before we go much further that this message may be, for some of us, the most challenging one yet. And some of you might feel like I'm pointing a finger at you or meddling in your business. And I assure you that I am just speaking to the human condition here. And I'm not referring to any specific situation. But if you start to feel uncomfortable, pay attention to that. Because it could be the Holy Spirit trying to say something to you. Is that fair enough? We're going to start, as we do each week, with the words of Jesus. And today that means we begin with mercy. Jesus said, "Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy." We often talk about mercy and grace as if they are interchangeable. They do work together, but they are not the same thing. Grace is the unmerited favor of God. It is a gift that we cannot earn and that comes without strings. Mercy is withholding harsh treatment or punishment, even if it's warranted. Mercy is a reprieve. It's a pardon. So on the receiving end, grace is getting a wonderful gift that you don't deserve. And mercy is not getting harsh treatment, even if you deserve it. And my claim is to really understand mercy, we have to understand forgiveness. In our culture, we have diluted forgiveness into a transaction of words. So two people may have conflict with each other, and someone will say, "I'm sorry," and the other one says, "Don't worry about it," and then they go their separate ways with feathers still ruffled, with the conflict still intact. That's not forgiveness. Forgiveness, you might be surprised to learn, can happen without an apology. Because true forgiveness happens in the heart of the person who has been hurt. To forgive is to overcome anger and resentment. To forgive is to overcome anger and resentment. That means forgiveness is where mercy begins. I mean, you could let someone off the hook without forgiving them, just so you wouldn't have to deal with that person anymore. But the inner conflict remains. And that's not really mercy, because mercy includes compassion and care for the other person. It keeps us from dehumanizing each other. And so can forgiveness. And that's what makes it so difficult. But if you hear nothing else today, please hear that you need to be aware. You need to beware of any brand of forgiveness that tells you you must receive an apology first. Apologies can be nice to hear. But talk is cheap, and there's no assurance that we won't be hurt again. And that's why it's really important to understand that forgiveness is much more about what happens in the heart of the person who has been hurt than it is about the remorse of the person who has hurt us. Forgiveness is much more about what happens in our hearts than it is about the remorse of the person who hurt us, because it's a practice, it's a spiritual practice. For Jesus, it's actually a matter of prayer. So turn to Matthew 6, verse 12, and I will show you. We are still in the Sermon on the Mount. We're in the passage in Matthew 6 that we call the Lord's Prayer. And Jesus has been teaching about prayer. He's been talking about honoring God as holy and asking for daily provision and bringing the kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. And then in verse 12, he says, "Forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors." In the United Methodist tradition, we often say, "Forgive us our trespasses." At Morningstar, we say, "Forgive us when we hurt others, as we forgive those who hurt us. So the description of this wrong action is not as important as the nature of forgiveness. We're talking about a process. That's why we say, as we forgive. Forgive us as we forgive others. Offering forgiveness is an expectation of followers of Jesus. And it's not easy. Jesus goes on a few verses later to say, if you forgive others, God will forgive you. And if you don't forgive others, God will not forgive you. It's easy to misunderstand that verse because of the differences in the society that we live in and the first century Mediterranean world. But in its original context, the statement of Jesus was not referring to eternal salvation. Forgiveness in his culture was not about emotional or even interpersonal healing. It was about restoring the balance in the community. If someone in the community remained unforgiven, the whole community would have suffered, and that in turn would have created misalignment between the community and God. Honestly, I think the same thing is true for us today. We just don't look at it that way because we live in a very individualistic society. But what I'm saying is, when we choose not to forgive, we construct a barrier between ourselves and other people and between ourselves and God, a barrier of our own making, because the truth is, ultimate forgiveness is already ours. Jesus did that on the cross before he died. Let's turn now to Luke 23, and we'll read together verses 32 through 34. Luke 23, verse 32. This passage is most often read on Good Friday, but it's relevant every day of the year. So at this point in the story, Jesus has been condemned to death, and he is being led to the place where he will be nailed to the cross. So let's read Luke 23. I'll read verses 32 through 34. Two others also who were criminals were led away to be put to death with him. And when they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And then Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Forgive them. They do not know what they're doing. So let's think about this together for a moment. Here we have Jesus literally dying on the cross after being betrayed, falsely accused, unjustly condemned, brutally beaten, and abandoned by his closest friends. And he offers forgiveness before the deed is even done. Forgiveness. Forgiveness, my dear friends, does not require an expression of remorse on the part of the person who hurt us. There's no cause and effect relationship between apologies or even repentance and forgiveness. That means forgiveness is an act of mercy. But here's the really upside down part. When we learn to forgive, when we learn to be merciful, we recognize our need for mercy and our need for forgiveness. And that's what our prayer of confession is all about. We are not good at confessing in our culture. So every week during our sacrament of Holy Communion, we pray together a prayer of confession. We confess our sin, sin with a capital S. We confess our sin not because we must do so to be forgiven, but because we need to be reminded that we are forgiven. And as people who have been granted grace and mercy, we can do better in extending grace and mercy to others. Because in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. These are words of assurance. We share those with each other every week as well, because no United Methodist confession is complete without them. They're also known as words of pardon, words of mercy. This is the way of Jesus. And bless his soul, my 8-year-old gets it better than most people. I asked Augie recently why it's so important for him to say, I forgive you, when someone hurts him. because that's what I want to hear, he said. That's what I want to hear. That's what I need to hear. I forgive you. So here is our charge for this week. We're taking a page from Augustus James today. Our charge is to resist the urge to say to someone who apologizes you, don't worry about it, forget about it, it's no big deal. Instead, say, I forgive you, and mean it. And remember, choosing to forgive doesn't mean that you are dismissing bad behavior and certainly not allowing abusive behavior to continue. That's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about letting go of anger and resentment. And so that brings us to the second part of the challenge. The first is to say, I forgive you when someone apologizes. The second is to forgive without being asked. To forgive someone who has not and may not ever offer you an apology. I know it sounds ridiculous, foolish even. We might as well be boarding a starship to the moon. Thank you. It was a good job, Job and Jude. It was good. It does sound ridiculous. It does sound foolish, and it is. It is upside down. It's upside down. But let me ask you a question. How many people does it take to forgive? Yeah, it takes two people to be reconciled, right? It only takes one person to forgive. You do not need anyone's permission to forgive them. You don't need anyone's permission to forgive them. But I promise you, you will be glad that you did, because forgiveness will set you free from the burden of anger and resentment that you have been carrying around. It's one of the most difficult, but also most transformational spiritual practices, forgiveness. And you can do it by the grace of God, by the grace of the God who has already forgiven you. And when you do, you will learn the meaning of life. When you are able to forgive before the deed is even done, you will learn the meaning of life. Because when we learn to give and receive mercy, that's when we can be truly happy. Amen? Amen. We're moving into a time of prayer. So kids, that means in your worship bags, you will find a wooden cross that looks like this. So you can hold the wooden cross and you can be reminded when we pray that we are connected to God and to each other. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we come before you asking for the strength and grace to forgive others as you have forgiven us. Help us to let go of any bitterness, anger, or resentment that may remain in our hearts. Teach us to show mercy to those who have wronged us, remembering that your mercies are new every morning. And as we seek to forgive, we ask for your forgiveness for the times we have failed to show mercy. Cleanse our hearts and renew our spirits and fill us with love that covers a multitude of sin. As followers of Jesus, may we reflect your mercy in all of our actions by the power of the Holy Spirit so that others may see your love through us. Amen.